and a big warm welcome to the Bristol International Balloon Fiesta. This three-day celebration of hot air rising is one of the biggest and brightest free shows in Europe. Now today we fly with the pilots on their frequently hazardous trips to uncertain destinations. We go on the country's first night flight and we discover how the secrets of the landscape can be revealed from balloons like these.
Taking off is rarely a problem when the weather's fine because the pilots are aware of the conditions. But landing can be another matter entirely, sometimes very exciting and unpredictable, as I found out at the publicity launch for the Fiesta in the Bristol city centre.
What a wonderful sight. Now this is as close as any balloonist likes to get to shops and other buildings without getting a rather nasty surprise. So they need special permission to take off here in the middle of Bristol. But as they're trying to attract as much attention as possible, this is an ideal place to start from. Me is Neil Croucher from Bristol 2000. Neil, what do you think of all this?
This is fabulous, isn't it? What fun, and what a way to see the city and to see the site. You know, there it is down there, the site that Bristol 2000 will eventually occupy. And down there will be three huge critical mass sites in Science World, a new exploratory, Wild Screen World, an environmental centre, and a massive and stunning new Colston Hall called the Centre for the Performing Arts. I must say, this morning is absolutely fabulous, isn't it? Oh, wonderful.
It is well worth getting out of bed at 5:30 to see, I can tell you. Bristol is extraordinary. It's so beautiful from up here. You can see so many different things.
All the little squares and spaces and all the nooks and crannies that you can't normally see, which are behind boarded fences and so on. We're just coming up to Clifton College and the Catholic Cathedral and so on.
Well, this is one view of the zoo I don't think we usually see. It's incredible. Look at the canines.
Never seen anything like this.
And I think we've just woken the ducks up. We seem to be very close to the trees at the moment. I hear landing is the interesting bit.
It certainly is.
Malcolm's not saying an awful lot at the moment. We do have a tree coming right for us. In fact, we're very, very close to the tree.
Okay, through the tree.
I don't believe this.
Through the tree.
Oh! This guy is a nutter.
Nonsense. He's a licensed nutter.
We just went straight through a tree. Malcolm, do we always tip over when we land? Somebody has just over there.
It's not compulsory, but I can arrange it for you.
We're going for the road. We've just gone past the road. And Malcolm, we're at 45 degrees. Is this normal?
Yes, it's pretty much a standard landing, really.
Really? I've just got to know everybody very well in the basket, having a major cuddle here.
It's a great way of meeting new people and making friends.
Here we go. Well, we are now on the floor, in the middle of the downs. It's 7 o'clock in the morning, but it's great fun, actually. I don't believe this. As well as an obvious talent for avoiding obstacles like trees and executing perfect landings, balloonists also claim to have a natural sense of rhythm. Mind you, how they look on the dance floor is another matter. But they do get a chance to demonstrate their musical dexterity by firing their burners on command at night in time to music. Well, sometimes.
It looks gloriously simple, but it's actually quite complicated. Pilots really have to concentrate on what they're doing. It's very noisy. Carefully to the radio and to listen to your colour, your number, your letter, the side you're on.
Get set, burn!
We'll be right back.
overall effect is great, but for the actual pilots, it's actually quite hard work.
What if you burn at the wrong time?
Well, you hope nobody notices, but you have to concentrate so that you get it right. Is where pilots from all over the world gather before each flight for the pilot's briefing. In here is essential information like weather conditions, possible landing flights, and more importantly, what's for breakfast. Come on in.
Cash prize of £250 and of course the trophy itself. That is open for the furthest distance flown.
Do you like getting up early?
Sometimes it's a little bit rough, but...
So why'd you do it?
Because it's fun.
Because it's the last surviving adventure. What else can you do when you don't know what's going to happen when you set off on a trip? And that's half the fun.
And so what is it you get out of it?
Oh, an enormous thrill. I mean, you get to my age, you need a few thrills.
This is absolutely magic. You don't realise you've come off the ground.
I know, look at that. Just look at that. Isn't it amazing?
Suddenly we're all this feet up.
Absolutely.
It's wonderful. What's the weather like today for flying?
Not great, actually. You know, it's a bit windy, and I have to concentrate a little hard just to see where we're going.
See where we're going.
I mean, we're actually moving away from the ground quite quickly. That's not because we're going up, it's just the wind's taking us away very fast.
What is it you get from this ballooning?
It's magical, really. I mean, it's magic carpet stuff. You can't really describe it. I mean, you've flown once or twice now, and it's just being a free spirit. You know, you don't know where you're going to go, you don't know where you're going to end up, and it's just brilliant.
And even the early starts?
Oh, God, you can sleep in the winter, can't you?
You look wonderful at this time in the morning, I know.
I've seen a few early mornings recently, but no, it's brilliant stuff. And yeah. I'm very happy to get up early to go flying, for sure.
Doesn't that mean you have no social or home life?
Not in the summer. You know, that goes beside the board in the summer, but in the winter I catch up on all of that.
Can I ask you, is it difficult being a lady pilot?
It's, I get a lot of stick.
Well, the guy who gives you some
jet fuel. Sure. Commercially, there aren't very many female pilots, so, you know, if you do the slightest thing wrong, then the men always jump down on you and say, oh, it's another woman flying, you know, or whatever. So anything you do wrong, then the men will pick you up on. The fact that they may do the same thing twice a week is neither here nor there.
Of course, you see so much from a balloon. Just look at that fabulous view of the Clifton Suspension Bridge. But some people see so much more than others. Put an archaeologist up here, and, well, they think they're in heaven because the landscape looks like a huge historical tapestry revealing all sorts of secrets, as long as you know where to look.
I'm Mark Horton from the University of Bristol, and we're hoping to go up on a hot air balloon to see a whole series of archaeological sites. If we get up above sites, we can see them so much more clearly than from the ground. And as it's evening, we'll get light which will show the shadows of where the buildings and remains are. We're just coming up over the edge of the Mendips now. The Mendips, of course, being made of limestone. You've got lots of quarries along the edge of the scarp here. And there's a particularly good group down there, presumably 17th, 18th century quarries. And you can actually see part of the remains where the building stone has been taken out. Gosh, this is an archaeologist's dream up here. The Mendips, of course, is made not only of limestone, but also very rich mineral reserves. And certainly the Romans were the first people to come and exploit these minerals. We know from our archaeological excavations just down the left, a place called Charterhouse was first exploited around 50 AD. When the Romans mined lead here. Directly underneath us here is the most extraordinary earthwork. We think that it might be remains of a Roman amphitheatre that was built for the small town that was set up down here. There we see Cheddar Gorge, which is one of the great natural wonders of Britain, formed by the collapse of a underground river system, probably, several million years ago. It's been the focus of human settlement. The caves that run underneath it have been investigated by cavers and archaeologists, have remains of Mesolithic man, Neolithic man, even some skeletons have been excavated. Oh, look, there's deer. This is, of course, very much what the Mendip Forest would have looked like in the medieval period. It was a royal hunting area where people would come, the king and his nobles would come up and hunt for deer and wild animals up here. There's very little evidence of medieval farms up on the top here. They were all concentrated down in the valley below. Hot air ballooning is more than just a sport. If you know what to look for, you can see the landscape below like an open book, with every period of occupation revealed, from the prehistoric to the Roman to the medieval. It is really an eye-opener.
Another real eye-opener at this year's Fiesta was also a first for the country. The Dawn Patrol took to the skies late at night and only landed when it was light enough to do so, though it did have people wondering whether they were seeing little green men as the balloons crossed the night sky.
Hi, I'm Paul Spellwood, and I'm here in Ashton Court at 3 o'clock in the morning, ready for what we're calling the night patrol. This will be the first time in the UK that we've had a group of balloons fly in the middle of the night. We won't be landing in the night, we'll have to fly until it's light enough to land after sunrise. We've got special radar equipment we're using to show the airport where we are while we're flying along. All the balloons will be linked together, talking to each other on the radio as we go, and the idea is to have a nice team flight starting from here in Bristol, and hopefully a nice gentle landing somewhere over towards Bath.
Just climbed out from Ashton Court, and it almost makes me feel like we should whisper. It's very quiet, it's pitch black. We're picking up the lights just coming up over our horizon as we go out over the trees. And looking out across town now, it's just like fairyland, and it's quite peculiar. Everybody lying in their beds. One or two dogs are barking, which we apologise for if anybody's been woken up for them. And it's just wonderful, like fairyland, that's all I can say. The biggest problem is we can't land at night because of wires, electrical cables, etc., and various hazards. So we take off about an hour and a half before sunrise and fly off into the night, and then watch sunset from 2,000 or 3,000 feet, and then drop down and land during the daylight.
Night flight proved that the spirit of adventure still burns just as brightly today as it did when man first went up in a hot air balloon over 2 centuries ago. Now, you don't have to be super fit to enjoy this sport. In recent years, less able-bodied people have found that joys can be found in the peace of the skies.
My name's Trevor Jones. Was a Navy helicopter pilot until about 8 years ago when I broke my neck in a skiing accident. My first introduction to ballooning was pretty unique in that it was when Richard Branson and Lindstrom's balloon came out of the sky in the Irish Sea, and we ended up picking them both out the drink. So it's ever since then I've had an interest in from a distance, an interest in ballooning, what was that, nearly 10 years ago? So this is the first opportunity I've had to get airborne, so it's particularly exciting for me. I'd recommend it to anyone, especially somebody who's disabled in any way. I mean, it's particularly good, I think, if you are disabled to get to change and try new environments and to sort of get out of the usual confines of everyday life. And experiencing the freedom of the skies, whether it's in a light aeroplane or a balloon, I think is a great, great experience, a great escape in a way for everyone.
These modern-day balloons are a far cry from the early models, which were made out of paper and linen. And because the air was heated by a bonfire, there were an awful lot of accidents. But modern-day technology, materials and know-how have turned the sport into something that's both eye-catching and exciting.
Hi, I'm Alan Noble. Welcome to Cameron Balloons. I'd like to show you how we get one of our balloons from the drawing board into the sky. I mentioned drawing boards, but of course these days the guys in the graphics department use the most sophisticated modern computer-aided technology to produce any design from a maple leaf to a space shuttle to a flying dinosaur to Mickey Mouse, whatever. From here, the balloon is panelled, electronic images go to plotters where brown paper patterns are cut out, and we use these as templates, and the templates in turn are placed over fabric, the fabric's cut out, and then it's built into the final balloon. Well, we've seen the fabric cut, it's been bundled up, and now it's come up here into this department to be sewn. The actual fabric itself doesn't take any of the strain. The white load tapes carry all the load, that's the people in the basket and all the fuel cylinders and the burner of the balloon itself.
Hi, my name's Anissa. I spend my life surrounded by nylon fabric, sewing it up every day. It may seem daunting to some people, sewing up a huge balloon, but to me, it's great fun, but it's very challenging. You have to make sure there's no faults in the fabric or the tape. You have to make sure there's two rows of stitching between four layers of fabric, or the seam has to be done again. It's a lot different to making clothes. You can imagine the size of a jumper compared to the size of a huge balloon. You do take people's lives into your own hands.
Hi, I'm Bridget. I work in the art department. This is quite an important part of the factory, I think, because we give each balloon its individual identity. We work from huge letters to detailed paintings, and it's our work flying in the sky, so we're quite proud of our department.
Every balloon envelope needs a balloon basket, and these were woven in Bridgewater. They're woven from Somerset willow and Malaysian cane, and we use these materials not just because they're traditional, but because they're strong. They add resilience, they help absorb shock. So they're the best product for the job. People, in fact, have tried building baskets out of carbon fibre, aluminium even, but in the end, they've always come back to wicker, because a wicker basket will give you a nice, safe landing.
I'm Don Cameron. It was my love of ballooning which made me start this business of making balloons more than 25 years ago, and we've since that time grown to be the largest in the world. In Bristol, we also have the largest balloon meeting in Europe. And that's a great excuse to party and get all these beautiful craft together again and see them flying. I think it's something, the best way to appreciate it is really to go flying yourself.
There's a lot more to the International Balloon Fiesta than just, well, balloons. After the morning launches, things could go awfully quiet until the evening if the organisers hadn't made sure there were still lots of things going on to keep the crowds entertained.
sadly, we had to finish making this programme without the valuable help of our very popular and bubbly presenter. Jill was injured during a particularly rough landing at Pilning near the Second Severn Crossing. She, cameraman Steve Stunt, and myself as the programme producer, had just taken off from Ashton Court in rather gusty wind conditions. As we flew over the Avon Gorge towards the Severn Estuary, she recorded this interview with pilot Austin Spindler.
OK, Austin, we're looking for somewhere to land. What are these marks on the map?
They show farms where farmers don't want balloons to land. It might be that they've had a bad experience with a balloon pilot in the past, or more likely it's something like a stud farm or ostriches or something which can react badly to the balloon flying low.
And what happens if by chance you do have to land in one of these areas? Don't they get really cross with you?
They can do, and you have to be very nice to them. And in fact, from the Fiesta, we're all carrying bottles of whiskey, which are quite a good way of soothing an angry farmer.
Sounds like a good bribe to me.
Yes, and if we land somewhere where there isn't a farmer, like a playing field, will we get to keep the whiskey ourselves?
Oh, so there's a ploy in this.
It could be.
Moments later, Jill was lying on the ground in considerable pain, unable to move and with an injured neck. Austin Spindler had decided it was necessary to land at that moment on a bone-hard field because the wind was picking up. We hit the earth at an estimated speed of around 20 miles an hour, and Jill, on the side of the basket which struck the ground, took the worst of it. Paramedics, specially trained in dealing with possible spine injury cases, took her to Southmead Hospital in Bristol, where she was detained for observation. But X-rays fortunately revealed that there was no bone damage. All of which raises the vital question of safety.
Well, ballooning is the safest aviation activity, and Civil Aviation Authority statistics over the last 20 years show that the number of accidents involved in ballooning is very, very small.
The problem seems to be that conditions can be fine when you take off, but they can deteriorate before it's time to land, and then you can be in trouble.
Well, it's true that conditions can vary, and one of the things that professional balloonists are taught is to anticipate changes in conditions and, of course, to match their flying techniques to the circumstances that are prevailing at the time.
Well, it's been a weekend of mixed fortunes as far as the weather's concerned, but there have been some wonderful moments and spectacular sights for the people in the West Country to enjoy. For us, of course, it was tinged with sadness. And we leave the last word to Jill, to whom we wish a speedy recovery, and who recorded her sign-off in typically chirpy style before her accident.
Well, that's it from this year's Bristol International Balloon Fiesta. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have.